See the entire Orange Bowl parade on Channel 4 New Year's Eve at 7:30. If you miss any section, see it New Year's morning at 9.
Apple's Way will not be presented tonight in order that we may bring you the following special tribute to Jack Benny.
Hello again. This is Jack Benny.
Good evening, I'm Charles Kuralt. Those of us who grew up in the 30s and 40s, how many millions of us must there be, all remember the violin, the tune, the voice, which together announced that Jack Benny was on the air again. No use dwelling long on the prosaic facts that he has died now of cancer of the pancreas, too late discovered at the age of 80 at home in Beverly Hills. We are still in memory, sitting down on the divan just before 7 o'clock on Sunday night, waiting for the Atwater Kent to warm up, waiting for that violin of rasping tone and that voice of faint exasperation, waiting to laugh. Jack Benny made you wait sometimes. Yes, this was the day of his funeral, and all of Hollywood was there. We'll get to that. But even on the day of a man's funeral, if the man was Jack Benny, it's all right to report that we, those of us who prepared this broadcast, have been listening to him again, and waiting with him again, and laughing.
Sure is dark tonight. No moon. Oh, well. Yadda-dee-da-dum, da-dee-da-dum, da-dum-dum-dee-da-da-dum.
Hey, Bud. Bud.
Huh?
You got a match?
Yes, I have one right here.
Don't make a move. This is a stick-up.
Mister, put down that gun.
Shut up. I said this is a stick-up. Now, come on. Your money or your life.
Look, Bud. I said your money or your life. I'm thinking it over.
Ladies and gentlemen, 35 years ago, I was doing a radio show on CBS here in New York, and I asked a very good friend of mine, Jack Benny, if he'd be a guest on my program. And Jack proved to be such a terrific hit that CBS immediately signed him for radio. Now, the rest is history, and here Jack Benny is to celebrate the 35th anniversary of that original date. My friend and your friend, Jack Benny. So let's bring him on.
It's true that Jack Benny spoke his first words on the air on an Ed Sullivan radio show in 1932. He said, "Hello, folks, this is Jack Benny." There will now be a slight pause for everyone to say, "Who cares?" By the time he celebrated that beginning on Sullivan's television show, the country had an answer. All of us, Jack Benny, we all cared.
You can leave now. I'm going to work alone. That was a nice introduction, but, ladies and gentlemen, everything that Ed Sullivan said about me during the introduction is true. I mean, 35 years ago, Ed Sullivan had a radio show, and I appeared on it as a guest. And because of my appearance, I got my own radio show, and it led into pictures and everything else. So whatever success I've enjoyed, I just want you to know that it's due to Ed Sullivan. I'm really thankful to Ed, but you want to know something? He has never let me forget it. Now, I've been on this show at least a dozen times, and I've yet to get paid. Every time I ask him for money, he says, "Jack, look what I did for you. Without me, you'd be nothing." Now, I'll tell you how I happen to be here tonight. About a week ago, I was in New York, and I ran into Sullivan, and he asked me to be on his show tonight, April 30th. So I said, "All right, Ed, I'll be glad to. Now, how much money do I get?" And he said, "Nothing." And I said, again nothing? He said, Jack, you keep forgetting what I did for you. But I said, Ed, that was 35 years ago. How long do I have to be in bondage? You know, it's Passover. We're celebrating the Exodus. And he said, Jack, that's my offer. Take it or leave it. Then he raised his hand. The traffic parted, and we walked across the street. I still can't get a dime. Oh, before, and I want to do something, ladies and gentlemen, that has never been done in this theater before. I'd like to introduce somebody from the audience. I'd like to have you meet my wife, Mary Bird, who is sitting right there in the audience, and have her take a bow. I'm glad that she stood up and waved, because that makes her dress and the glove on her right hand deductible. Well, anyway, yes, Ed.
Wait a minute, Jack. Hold it. Please hold it.
What is it?
Well, I don't like the tone that this thing is taking. I don't mind what you say about me, but it's my job, don't you understand, Jack? You introduce Mary, I introduce people to our audience.
You introduce football players, Mary.
He was named Benjamin Kubelski when he was born in Chicago on Valentine's Day in 1894, son of a Russian immigrant storekeeper. He said his father gave him a violin in case he had musical talent and a monkey wrench in case he didn't. He never learned to use the monkey wrench. He quit school in the ninth grade to go on the stage. The stage was that of the Barrison Theater in Waukegan. But he didn't want to stop with Waukegan. He wanted to play, well, Milwaukee too. So he formed his first vaudeville act with a woman pianist, Cora Salisbury. Salisbury and Benny. And Ben K. Benny, as he called himself, during an act with her, told his first joke. The audience laughed. And that laughter ended his days as a serious musician. During World War I, he clowned his way across the country with a Sailor's Road Show. And after the war, he became a vaudeville headliner, developing during all the years of the 20s the little bits, the squeaky violin, the silences and double takes, that in the 30s made him at once the most popular performer on the radio.
Oh, pardon me, are you the ticket clerk?
So what do you think I am in this cage, a canary?
Well, don't get huffy about it. All I want is a ticket on the cheese.
Oh. Would you like the $60 ticket or the $140 ticket?
Well, what's the difference?
Well, with the $140 ticket, you ride inside.
Well, naturally, I want to ride on the inside. After all, you know, I'm not as young as I used to be.
You're not as young as anybody used to be.
Now, don't get fresh. All I want is a ticket to New York.
Return trip?
No, one way.
Good.
No, Monsieur Benny, please tune up the violin. I will make the A on the piano. No, you are flat. Pull the string up a little tighter.
Okay.
Tighter.
Oh, darn it, the string broke.
Good, that's one down and three to go. Here's your violin. We'll start with the piece I gave you last time. What was it again?
The glowworm.
Oui, monsieur, the glowworm. It is very pretty. Commence.
Okay.
Professor Benny. Monsieur Benny, it is such a small worm. Do not kill it.
Oh, I'm sorry. I'll take it again.
Monsieur Benny, what are the blink blinks?
I'm stepping over the worm.
Hey, boys.
Yes, Benny.
Will you drive my Maxwell in, please?
Oh, sure.
Now, be careful, fellas. It's a high-powered car there, you know. That note is by Stokowski. Well, how is the car on gas?
Well, I get about 4 miles to the quart. If I insist, of course.
If you put your foot down.
Yes. Now, Freddy, I'm not begging you to take this car, only I thought, well, you walk all the time, you're not getting any younger. I think you ought to take your varicose veins out for a spin once in a while.
What are you asking for this Rhapsody in junk?
I'm asking $95 FOB.
FOB
for old Benny.
I played a character that included all the faults and the frailties. I think that's the right word, and the frailties of mankind. See, every family had somebody like me. Either they had an uncle who was stingy, or one who thought he was very sexy and he wasn't. So every family has that kind of a person. The different characterizations, you know, we made Phil Harris a sort of a smart alecky guy. He either left a pool room or a bar or a girl.
Well, that's about all I can take. I'm going to the bar and start warming up for New Year's Eve.
When Dennis came in, you knew he was always vague about something.
Now, look, now, let's go in the other room.
Well, see, and... Mr. Benny.
What?
You see this tie I'm wearing? My girl knitted it for me for Christmas.
A tie? What are those things hanging on the side?
She started to make a sweater and changed her mind.
Mary always sort of ran my life, even though she wasn't supposedly married to me.
I'm in my late 30s, or my early 40s.
You were in your early 40s in the gay 90s.
And I would see to it that the material I gave them almost fit their characters personally, and particularly their speaking voices.
The material fitted so well that we still think of Phil Harris as a hard-drinking band leader, and of Dennis Day as a naive tenor, and an actor named Artie Auerbach won a kind of immortality as Mr. Kitzel, who sold hot dogs with the pickle in the middle and the mustard on top. In our memory of 924 Jack Benny radio shows in 23 years, Don Wilson is still there, sneaking in the Jell-O commercials. And Frank Nelson goes on walking the floor forever as the uppity department store supervisor. Mel Blanc still squawks insults as Jack Benny's parrot, or wheezes and clunks as the engine of his old Maxwell. And as long as we remember that Jack Benny was 39, we'll remember that the brilliant Eddie Anderson was Rochester.
What can I do for you?
Oh, I'm trying to get a gift for my boss.
Your boss, eh? Well, what would you like?
Well, I don't know. Maybe you've got a suggestion.
Well, what kind of man is your boss? Is he the athletic type?
No.
Is he the intellectual type?
Well, no.
The executive type?
No.
Well, perhaps the outdoor type.
No.
Well, perhaps he's the playboy type.
No. I'm
afraid there isn't very much left.
That's him.
I just can't completely to put words together that would really explain my feeling right now. A great loss. Just like a member of my family.
Oh, mister.
Yeah.
Pardon me, are you the floor walker here?
Well, what do you think I am with this carnation? A float in the Rose Parade?
Always running. How can you keep a job as a floor walker?
My father owns the store.
Oh, and you're working your way up, huh?
No, I started as president.
He was certainly one of the greatest comedians that ever lived. What made him great?
Well, I think extremely careful attention to detail, and he did something that very few comedians do. If you stop and analyze, if you were to read a Jack Benny script and read Jack's lines, you would find he had nothing in the way of jokes, ever. He gave all his jokes to his people who surrounded him, and he built on the people that worked with him, which was a very lovely thing. And it showed a great security, because I've worked with comedians who, if you had a good joke, when you came back for the show, they had the joke, and you didn't have it anymore. But Jack never did anything like that, and I think that's one of the things that made his comedy different than other comedy.
Dennis, it's your deal.
Okay. Hey, Don, while I'm dealing, why don't you tell Jack about that idea you got?
What idea?
Well, Jack, I know I'm not a writer, but I have an idea I think would make a great television show.
You have, Don? What is it?
Well, you've heard of dual roles where an actor plays two parts.
Yeah, well, that's been done to death.
I know, Jack, but in this idea of mine, you play a triple role.
Triple role? Well, that would be different. What parts would I play?
Well, you play the part of a man, a boy, and a dog.
A dog? How could I play a dog?
You have to take your glasses off.
Dennis.
I know a place where you can get your ears clipped.
The world has lost a great man. The profession has lost a great man. Jack, above all, was a great human being, as I said a moment ago. And Jack was a very normal person in so many respects. He never went to a psychiatrist. He never had to. And Jack had a tremendous career, and those of us that have the privilege of being associated with him can thank him in an unlimited way for the opportunity that he gave us to be with him. He's considered among his peers as one of the real all-time greats of the profession. And the beautiful part about it, not only was so successful in his chosen work, but that he was, and I'm being repetitious, such a great human being with it all. It's a great loss, not only to the profession, but to the public at large. He was a member of an era that is fast dwindling in ranks, as we all recognize. And there just aren't people of that stature that are coming along on the scene today.
Jack was the catalyst of the whole program. He was played straight for all of us on the Jack Benny Show. I mean, all of the characters, Phil Harris, Don Wilson, Rochester. Jack was a straight man, and we got the laughs. He was never jealous. He was happy and delighted. And of course, he was, as I say, the greatest audience in the world. Frank Remley, all Jack had to do, and look at Frank, and said, Frank, and Frank would fall right off the stool that he was playing guitar. So Jack instilled that and inspired that, because it was a happy show, such a happy show. Every time I loved to go to the show, to the rehearsals, because you tingle and you knew that everything was going to be so happy. And fun. It was all fun. It was not like a job. It was like, really, when you look back at it, it was stealing money, because you enjoyed it so much, you'd pay to be on the program. And so many great stars of the 40s and the 50s would offer their services to Jack, you know, for nothing. They would want to go on the Jack Benny radio or television show, because they knew that the material they were going to get was going to be the best in the world.
Oh, pardon me, mister. But did my man come over and put some of my clothes in your luggage? Are you going to New York?
Sí.
Are you taking flight 18?
Sí.
What's your name?
Sai.
Sorry.
My man told me you were going to visit some relatives in New York.
Gee.
The sister?
Gee.
I'm afraid to ask this next one. What's her name?
Sue.
One of his favorite routines was the C-Psi routine, which I did with Jack for... We started in radio, and it went through television. And this is... we only had about 10 words of dialogue in the entire script. And it was very well received. It was a very popular thing. Jack was so natural. He talked. He didn't tell jokes. He just talked as he felt. And, of course, he had a little things planned. But he would tell a complete story and not make a joke out of it. And the incident was so funny that you had to laugh. It was just marvelous.
They all loved him. In its obituary, the New York Times, which tries to be careful with its facts, said it has always been impossible to find a colleague, or even a former colleague, to speak ill of him. Jack Benny, who was known to his friends as the most generous of men, who traveled hundreds of thousands of miles to entertain servicemen and women in four wars, who was forever playing benefits to save an orchestra or concert hall. This was the man who amused us for 50 years by portraying himself as a skinflint.
Hey, come on, where's your money?
I haven't got any.
Haven't got any? Listen, you're loaded.
I haven't got any with me.
Hey, this is Jack Benny. I read where he keeps his money. Come on, Benny, let's have your shoe.
There's nothing in my shoe. Look, it's empty. It's empty, see? That's just a gag that my writers write about me being cheap, that's all.
Yeah, well, we'll see. Hey, wait a minute.
What is it, Fingers?
Just watch this.
It's mad money.
We never grew tired of his tightwad routine, and he never gave it up, even though it was the opposite of the truth. Another of his routines was based on truth. He really did find Mary Livingston working in a department store. He met her and married her in 1927, and only years afterwards discovered that he had married an actress and comedienne.
Yes, ma'am. May I help you?
I hope so. I'm looking for some extra strong silk stockings, size 8.5.
Extra strong?
Yes. You see, I'm on the stage, and it's rather embarrassing if a stocking develops a run during your performance.
Well, we have some new three-thread hose that are very strong.
May I see?
Certainly.
Trying to attract my attention. Do you mind if I try these stockings on?
Well, it's not customary, but there's a dressing room right back there.
Thank you.
Hey, Mary, don't look now, but that guy's coming over here. Look, he's walking like Theda Bara.
Just a gigolo everywhere I go. Hello, kiddo. Where have you been all my life?
Avoiding it.
Hey, you're good. I like my tomatoes with a little spice.
Tell me, baby, what's your name?
Mary.
Mary what? Quite contrary? Oh, you beautiful doll. What's your full name?
Look, mister, my name is Mary Livingston. I was born in Plainfield, New Jersey. I know I should be in pictures, but I'm very happy here at the May Company. Now, what do you want?
Wait a minute, baby. Wait a minute. You got me all wrong. Now, Mary, I'm not trying to
get
fresh.
These stockings seem to be all right. I hope they're going to be strong enough. Let me see.
A lot of strange customers around here, don't you?
Aw, you're just self-conscious.
Jack Benny never really retired, but Mary Livingston did, and he was always being asked if Mary would ever come back.
Will you be working with Mary Livingston at all in the...
Well, fella, I'm gonna tell you something. If you can get my wife to come back and work with me, I'll make you a very rich man. I can't get Mary to do anything. And you know, it's kind of sad. And I'll tell you why I think it is. Because Mary, everybody loved Mary on my radio, television shows. And she was always nervous. She has worked with me for 25 years. And she was always nervous, and she never told me. I didn't know that until finally she came to me one day. She says, Jack, I'm not going on any longer. I said, why? And she told me that she's always nervous. Now, she never would show it, as most performers don't. They don't show their nervousness.
The Jack Benny television program went off the air 10 years ago, but Jack Benny never went off the air. He returned again and again in specials and guest appearances, and we grew used to seeing tributes to him, like the one Wayne and Schuster did so well in 1966.
His favorite people, Mr. and Mrs. Jimmy Stewart.
What are you going to have, Jack?
Watch him get a laugh just by reading a menu.
Well, I don't know. Let's see. Granadina beef, $3.75. Long Island duckling, $4.50. Filet mignon. Whoops! Oh, brother.
If you don't mind, I'll take the orders.
All right, I'll have granadina beef.
Mm-hmm. You, madame?
I'll have the Long Island duckling.
Very good, madame. You, sir?
I'll have the whoops medium rare.
Notice how he let Stewart take the last laugh, but also notice that the last laugh is on him. Here he's a gossiping old meanie with Carol Burnett.
Tell me, what's the lowdown on this Gary Moore guy? Well, I know he looks like such a nice fella, you know, on the surface, but, what is he really like underneath?
He is kind and sweet and considerate.
Oh.
And there's no one who's more loyal to his people than he is. He's thoughtful, helpful, lovely. Oh, and what an ad libber. I tell you,
Carol.
He's got the greatest sense of humor.
All right, all right.
Jack, you asked me.
I know, but if you can't say something bad about a person, be quiet.
With Marilyn Monroe, it's Benny the Great Lover.
Marilyn, why did you walk away from me? Why did you want to leave me?
Because I can't trust myself with you.
What?
You're so strong and I'm so weak. And when you look at me with those big blue eyes, I just...
I understand.